Namaskaram. Friends, I am a playwright and theatre director working with a small group called Justice Repertory in Chennai. I write and direct plays in English, but I always use a parallel track. What I mean by a parallel track is simply this. I don't compose the music after writing the play. You'd have guessed that my parallel track is music. I don't compose the music after writing the play as an add-on, a kind of a decoration or a superimposition. I write the music along with the text as I write the play, almost simultaneously. It's a natural process. At a very simple level, it's simply this. Let me take my first play called Dark Horse, which had for its protagonist a very great poet of the 20th century called Arun Kolatkar. Now, I had to use his poetry. And how do you use poetry on the stage? It's very difficult. Poetry is something very personal. You have to read it. It's not something that to be shared with a community. So this particular poem, I'm just going to take two words, key words from that to show how I presented that poem in this play. It's a poem about crabs. So how do you bring crabs to the stage? What I did was I had to, can you put that on? I had two young girls, a boy and a girl, playing children, and you would recognize Savita Narasimhan. She was a character on the stage. She was singing this. The characters, the boy and the girl, come to the beach and search for the crabs and suddenly find them. And I'll tell you how this is created. Look, Gappa, look, Gappa, just look at them. Gappa, Sappa, crabs. Gappa, Gappa, Sappa, Sappa, Sari, Sari, Magagari, Sani, Dappa, Magare, Sa, Rimadani, Gappa, Sari. The crabs have gone into the waves. They've disappeared. The children are afraid, and at the same time, they recognize the crabs. So what you do is you create the illusion of the crabs with the music and with the eyes of the actor and their movements. I'll give you just one more example. There's another poem by Arun Kolatkar, a very famous poem about a butterfly. Again, how do you bring a butterfly on the stage? Ah, the butterfly has come on the stage. Ah, it's sitting on a flower. Ah, it's drinking honey. It's gone. So this is how we create, I'm sorry I sang so badly, it's difficult to sing and speak. So you have a musician who sings along with the words the actors utter, and you create a parallel text and bring to the stage things which cannot be brought through words alone. Today, I'm going to share some aspects of the way I perceive music as essential and indispensable to my work in theatre. By music, I mean mainly Carnatic music. Though I have used some Hindustani and Western elements, I always use live music, not recorded music. And I'd love to share this fact with you that T.M. Krishna has sung for three of my plays brilliantly. You will agree that in literature, in prose or poetry, the meaning lies not in what is actually said, but what is left unsaid, what is implied, what is suggested, what is indicated. In theater, this suggested range of indefinable meanings is found not in the words of the dialogue, but what falls between the dialogues. I believe that music can make us grasp these meanings, this range of deep-rooted, multi-layered feelings bristling between the words. Here is an excerpt from a play, from one of my plays called One Day in Ashadha. It's actually not mine. It is by a great contemporary classical playwright, Mohan Rakesh. And this play is about the legendary poet Kalidasa. On the stage, I'm not using ragas simply to paint a scene. We know la 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 in love scenes in cinema. Or depict the mood, dhak, dhak, dhak in cinema means murder. Or identify a character as hero or villain. What I'm trying to do is to evoke this vast range of indefinable feelings, multi-layered feelings, immediately, unconsciously. These hidden feelings can be a premonition of some great disaster, as here, where the heroine Mallika realizes how desperate she is at parting from the man she loves, the poet Kalidasa. Kalidasa is dismissed as an idiot by the village in which he was born. Only loyal Mallika recognizes that he's a genius. She urges him to go to the royal court in Ujjaini, where she is sure he will be recognized as a great poet. The excerpt here is about the two characters, just as they are parting. And Kalidasa is off to Ujjaini. He doesn't know that the road to fame and wealth is going to end in his loss of creativity. While outwardly, Mallika is full of hope for his future, she is also filled with some unknown dread, though she doesn't know yet that Kalidasa will forget her and marry the Gupta princess. There are two contrasts here between ancient and modern. One, I have used Kalidasa's own verse, Megha Sandesham, as a play within a play, a small extract. This is, of course, as you know, about the yaksha who separated from his beloved. This is to show the inner turmoil of Mallika and Kalidasa, who are the characters in this modern contemporary play. Two, the music contrasts the beauty of poetry with the misery of life. And just one thing, though T.M. Krishna has sung for this particular play, I sometimes make actors, even though they're not trained musicians, to sing because it gives a different kind of dynamism to the text. To explain everything when you have a very short extract, but still I think you got the drift of the way I use music. I said that I've been using music to say what is not said through the words, but to say what lies between the words. But more importantly, I want to use music to suggest meanings in contrast to what is happening on the stage. Music then brings out the concealed feelings in the hearts of the characters. Feelings which are the opposite of what they are actually saying on the stage. So here, words are the illusion, music is the reality, it is the indicator. The next clip is from Sarpa Sutra. It is not a dance drama, though I have used two dance clips in order to explain the music. I have left out the drama part because it would take too long. And this dance is choreographed for the theater. The story is familiar, it's from the Mahabharata, where Arjuna and Krishna go to the Khandava forest on a picnic. Agni, the fire god, disguised as a Brahmin, comes to them and says, every time I try to burn up this forest, Indra, king of the gods, sends torrential rains and prevents me from burning it up. Oh, great warriors, Krishna and Arjuna, please destroy this forest so that I can eat all the trees, animals, birds, insects, and all the human beings, the tribals who live here. I will give you divine weapons. Test them out. This story is not told from the point of view of someone who leaves a record. This story is told from the point of view of a victim, someone, a snake woman, who is awaiting death by fire. So her approach to Krishna and to Arjuna will be completely different from the approach of Vyasa, though I have used Vyasa's verse. Disguised as a non-violent Brahmin begging for a meal, Agni is actually asking for a catastrophic holocaust, a genocide. So the music was not easy to arrive at. I arrived at it after a very ruminative process, because I want to explain that when we create music for theatre, we are not thinking of ragas or talas. We're thinking of the character, the situation, and the emotion that has to be portrayed by that character. And in this case, I wanted to show the underpinned emotions below a very familiar, heroic Mahabharata story. The sorrow and I wanted to bring out an iconoclastic element in this particular segment. So how do you do it? My raga had to do all these things. The life-teeming beauty and the life-giving serenity of a primal forest which is about to be destroyed. It had to show that beauty. The life-saving, life-preserving rain which protects the forest. That also I had to show. Nisha Rajagopalan, who sings here, had some problem with breath control in the rain of swaras. The greed in burning up trees and massacring all life, including human life. The cruelty and deceit hidden beneath Agni's innocuous request, I'm hungry, give me food. Agni pretending to be a sattvic Brahmin while actually acting like a rajasic demon. One more extract from the same production, because I think it'd be easier to make my point. In here, I don't know what raga it is, though it closely resembles Hamir, I guess. But Arjuna gets a divine bow, Gandiva, and Maheshudhi, the inexhaustible quiver, and a splendid ratham from Agni to destroy the forest. Now, the scene of a hero getting ready for battle is something that is so common in all the epics all over the world. I told Shijit Krishna, the dancer and choreographer, look, Arjuna is an invincible, peerless warrior. He's the archetypal hero. He's the protector of dharma. But here, the hero is using his skills not to establish dharma, righteousness, not to support nyaya, justice, but to massacre all life, destroy a primal forest. The Gandhara and the Madhyama in the raga, the dheem in the sulukattu, must have the twang of the great bow ready to destroy and kill, ready for bloodshed. And this must not only show Arjuna's unrivaled power, but it must make us shiver, not with admiration, but with horror. And I used a common ragam, a raga that is associated with energy and valor, Gambhiranate. But I'm using it to satirize the situation. It's a parody of the raga. It is a parody of the situation, the parody of the hero also. That's why I chose a common raga. This is not to elevate the character, but to satirize the hero, as I said, who in this context, in my context, in the context of the victim snake woman who's about to die in the fire, Arjuna is the anti-hero. Let's have it.
You must have heard of Janamejaya's great-grandfather, Arjuna. Arjuna, the great superhero. A wizard with a bow, he had no equal in archery. But he received divine weapons, a divine bow, two inexhaustible quivers, and God knows what happened to him. Just went berserk, I guess. For the first act of heroism he performed, as soon as he got the new toys in his hands, was, well, this. He burnt down one of the largest rainforests in the land. And what a thorough job he made of it. Reduced it completely to ash.
Tat dim, tat dim, tat dik, tat dik, tat dik, dhalang kutum, tat dhalang kutum, tat dik dhalang kutum, tat dim, tat dim, tat dik, tat dik, tat dik, dhalang kutum, tat dhalang kutum, tat dik dhalang kutum, dhalang kutum, tat dim, dim, tat dim, kin natum, dhalang kutum, tat dim, dim, tat dim, kin natum, dhalang kutum, tat dim, dim, tat dim, kin natum.
Composing swaras for theatre performance is completely different from composing swaras for a dance drama performance or, of course, in a concert. Because what you're trying to do is to tell the story through the swaras. You're actually creating the character, the sense of horror. Here, the Veera of Arjuna is converted to Bhayanaka and Bibhatsa. The man, you know, Arjuna was called Bibhatsa, one who was disgusted at the thought of wrongdoing. The man called Bibhatsa is performing an act which is full of Bibhatsa. I come to the end of this presentation with a very small extract. And we have seen romance. We've now seen tragedy. Let's end with a comedy. A scene from a play called Rural Fantasy. A play set in the 1940s. A tiny village in Tamil Nadu is rocked off its foundation by the arrival of a very beautiful young woman from Shantiniketan. Remember, this is 1940 during the national struggle. She is a firebrand reformist, a Gandhian. She wants to change the entire village. All the village boys, of course, are mesmerized by her youth and beauty. And what she does is, in her khadi sari, she comes around and asks them all to spin the charkha and to clean the streets in a huge reformist binge. T.M. Krishna and Sangeeta Shivakumar sang this so beautifully, I can't tell you. Here you will hear Sangeeta Shivakumar and Amrita Murali adding to the fun. You may be surprised by my choice of music for this. I didn't have to compose it. It was there for me, ready-made. I used it. Enjoy. Thank you so much for listening to me.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. May I also end by thanking the organizers, T.M. Krishna, Ikatraman, for inviting me here to present this, to share my experiences with you, especially in the August presence of such great Vidwans. It's such an Ashirvadam for me. Thank you.